When am I the fool, the right to call the tight end? Then when I hold the mindset, when are you getting married? Hello, everybody. My name is Eric D. Johnson, also known as Bright Shine. I live right here in the city of Memphis in the state of Tennessee, in the county sheriff. Today's date is early Sunday morning, August 7th, 2016, time 3:01 a.m. First, I thank you all my fans, my support, and continue to encourage me and support me. I continue to keep myself employed right here in this Memphis tri-state area. I'm going to continue to further my education more by online pursuit by social media. Instead of being a track construction marketing. The music you hear in the background, that's African hip hop, radio back home. But today, video, we're going to continue to talk about African traditional religion. Turn the radio down. Turn the radio down. We're going to continue to talk about, or today, baby, we're going to continue to talk about African traditional religion. African traditional religion is being taught. It's being taught in institutions of higher learning, colleges, universities, in sub-Saharan Africa. You can earn a bachelor's degree, master's degree, PhD in African traditional religion. Where sub-Saharan Africa, well, let's get the map. This map here, this is referred to as a language map, but what it does show, it shows you sub-Saharan Africa. Now the people that's being shown on this map, because this is a language map, it shows you the people that, the language that they speak, the blue color, that's the Afro-Asiatic, the yellow color, that's Nilo-Saharan, the dark orange color, that's a Niger Congo A. And you see a little bit of little light orange color. That's your Niger Congo B, Bantu. Now this is the other half of the map. It shows you sub-Saharan Africa. And it also shows you the color code. It tells you that the blue color is the Afro-Asiatic. It tells you that the yellow color is the Nilo-Saharan. It tells you that the dark orange color is the Niger Congo A. It tells you that the light orange color is the Niger Congo B, Bantu. Now that green color, that's the koi and the sand. When you see koi sand, that's not one group of people, that's two groups of people, the koi people and the sand people. You have a group of people that are pastoralists. And then you have another group of people that are hunter-gatherers. That's the sand people. The sand people are the hunter-gatherers. The core people are pastoralists. Then you see that lavender purple color over there on the island of Madagascar. That's the Austronesian. Now the Austronesians are the people that live in Indonesia. The people that live in Indonesia left Indonesia. And when they left Indonesia, they settled and colonized Madagascar. They're not originally from Madagascar. They settled. They left Indonesia and they settled in Madagascar, colonized Madagascar. Now, this is another map that shows Niger Congo, and it shows you Sub-Saharan Africa. And like I said, when I copied this map off the computer, off the printer, the lower part of it got kind of cut off just a little bit. Now it tells you in Niger Congo language. It tells you that the Niger Congo language, the primary branches are Volta Congo, the South Volta, the Bantu of the sides, Bantu, your other East Benue Congo, your West Benue Congo, and your Kwe. Then you have your North Volta, Kru, Sanufo, your Gert, Volta languages, your Adamawa, and your Bunjin. Then you have your other primary branches. You have your Kordofan, your Mandi, your Atlantic, and your Dogon. Now this is another map that shows you Sub-Saharan Africa. Now this map, it shows you Sub-Saharan Africa. It shows you the Niger Congo. Your Atlantic group, your Wolof, your Fule. And it includes Sierra, the Mandi, Bambari, your Mandingo, your Dayule, your Kru, your Gur, including Mori, your Kwe, Bali, Akan, Iwi, your Dogon, your Ajor, your Adamawa, your Bunjin, Jabaye, Banda, Zandi, your Kordofanians, your non-Bantu, such as Yoruba, the Igbo, your Bantoid, Fang, Tiki, Lingala, Mungo, Nkundu, Congo, Choki, Lube, Luganda, Rwanda, Rundi, Sukume, Kikuyu. Now your Bantu, Swahili, Makuwe, Nyanje, Bimbe, Shone, Tsange, Northern Soto, Zulu, Southern Soto, Xhosa, Tswana, Ndonga, Umbundu, and there are many others that are not listed, but there are many others. On today's video, before we get to our reading, that's the thing we want to get to. Let me find one thing. Yeah. Before we get to anything, man, we was over here on the hip hop thing here. Now we was on the African hip hop. I was watching Africa 54, the Voice of America, Africa 54. And it was, you know, I was informed that the man who initiated rap, hip hop, was from the African nation of Ghana. And I'm gonna turn this down because there was an interview that was given on Africa 54, and the man's name Jidu Blay Mboli. He the man that started rap before the Sugar Hill Gang. Recorded in 1978, this man from the African nation of Ghana. Now I know about James Brown, and you know we know about people, you know, but we talking about rap, hip hop. I think his name's right. Before the Sugar Hill Gang did their recording. Because Sugar Hill Gang did their recording in 1978, and like this man said, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, this man is a man from the African nation of Ghana. His name is Jidu Blay Mboli. Now, there was an interview that he gave on Voice of America, Africa 54, and the man who gave the interview, one of the reporters, Vince McCord. Let's go to the interview here. Let's go to the interview. That way you can listen to the interview. On Music Makers.
Press Music Makers Friday, and with us today is Jidu Blay Mboli. In high life or hip life musician, affectionately also known as Simikwa Dolan. Jidu Blay, welcome.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, first, I just don't know why you also call that by the other name there, Simikwa Dolan.
Because when you talk about rap music,
yes,
I'm the one who started rap music.
You started rap music in Ghana?
Yes. Oh. Not in Ghana, but in the whole world.
In the whole world.
Yes. When you go to the Guinness Book of Records, they say that it was a Sugar Hill Gang that came out with rap.
Yeah.
If you check the date, there's in Iran, 1978, 79.
Yeah.
Mine came out in 1973.
Wow.
Yes.
You remember your lines then?
1973.
Yes, yeah, I do. Yeah. Yeah, it's all about my mom's stomach, my father, 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 my So these were the things that
built from there.
Yeah.
So over the years, how has your music developed, and eventually it encompassed so many other influences, other forms of music? What do you call yourself now?
The way I think I've grown in my music, because where I came from, I was a port city, and the seamen were bringing music coming from America, soul music, James Brown, and all that.
Yeah.
And we have the local musicians as well.
Yeah.
And trying to build up my own style of music, I came out with a dance, I came out with a rhythm that belongs to me, and I came out with lyrics that also belong to me.
Okay.
Because looking at what James Brown was doing, James Brown had his own way of music, dance, and lyrics as well. So that motivated me to be able to put put all these things together.
Okay, but I want to just showcase also how you managed to collaborate with the younger generation. I'm going to play a video here. Do you remember this? You co-produced with someone else.
Yes, I remember this because since I'm the one who started, the younger ones that are coming started collaborating with me.
Yeah.
So that's one of them that you've seen.
Let's watch this video. Let's watch this video. Of that, but you know, how do you feel like being able to now also, you know, get together with this really younger fellows with new styles? You're sitting there like a king. Are you learning from them or are you teaching them?
Well, I'm learning from them as well because they're also coming out with something new and things like that. But I'm the tree,
yeah.
And they are the branches, you know, and them coming back to collaborate with me because many a time they know that I'm the one who started it. And, you know, the continuation of it. They come to see me stumbling, can we collaborate with you on this and all that? And I keep on advising them that, you know, music is a trade. If they want to learn it, then they have to learn it properly because, you know, every country has its form of music, and that's where the identification is coming from.
Yeah. So, okay. Yeah. In the next few weeks, maybe I'll play one of your most, let's say, favorite songs. Tell me which one that will be, and I'll play it on this show.
Okay, there's a song called Everything You Do, God Sees You.
Okay.
So it's very important that, yes.
Yeah, because we don't have a lot of time today, but I'm happy that you know, visited us and we get to talk a little bit.
Thanks for talking with you.
I appreciate it so much. Well, that's Judo Play. Judo Play, humbly, who's a Guinean high life or high peak life musician, and is also known as a semi-guided dope man.
Thanks a lot. So everybody, when it comes to hip hop, rap, when it comes to rap, hip hop. So, G-Doo, Blade, and Bowling, he recorded his rap song, his rap music, in 1973, before the Sugar Hill Gang. He recorded theirs in 1978. So, G-Doo, Blade, and Bowling, he is the first person ever, anywhere, that recorded rap music. African man from the African nation of Ghana, G-Doo Blake and Bole. Now, what I was looking for, you know, before that, what I was looking for, I had already heard about it, but, you know, we've been talking about getting doing some of these street games. Make sure that we get in contact with the Niger Congo and Sub-Saharan and get them informed about this street gang in Chicago, Illinois, and drug gang in Chicago, Illinois. Get in contact with the Niger Congo and Sub-Saharan. Get them informed about the street gang in Los Angeles, California, and the drug gang in Los Angeles, California. And, what I was looking for, I found, because I had heard about it, and I mistakenly didn't write it down, but I heard about it. And, it kind of pissed me off, which it did piss me off. when I heard about it because it didn't sound right. And I'm gonna let you hear what it was. Let me go over here to, I'm gonna go to the Huffington Post first. Huffington Post first. Because they, it's reported also in Essence. So I'm gonna go over here to Huffington Post first. It says here the title is Teens Ask for Summer Jobs After Gangs Try to Recruit Them. Teens Ask for Summer Jobs After Gangs Try to Recruit Them. Do that sound right? Do it sound right? It don't even sound right. These four young black men. Let me see, it says here from left to right. Desmond Woodard, Dalek Smith, Jalen Parham, and Dion Woodard. Four young black men. They live at LaGrange Housing Authority in Georgia. They have gotten summer jobs working for their community after months of persistence. And said they all ganged up to stay out of gang. They didn't want to be in a gang. But that's a good thing. That's a good thing. When I was growing up, I didn't want to be in no gang either. I wanted no street gang. I'm still not in no street gang. It's the right thing to do. It don't sound right. Don't sound right at all. And the reason why it don't sound right, why are the gang members outnumbering the people who are not in a gang? That's the reason why it don't sound right. See, you when you say something like that, you out of place. See, it don't supposed to be nobody nowhere. When you have all these schools, you have elementary school, you have junior high school, you have high school. In all these schools, you have teachers, you have counselors, you understand, you have a vice principal. They all been to college. Supposedly, they all supposed to have education. And in the community, you supposed to have people with education. So why is it that the street gang outnumber the people who are not in a gang? That's the reason why it don't sound right. Why you got all these grown-ass people walking their ass around, talking about they got a degree, talking about they're in the street gang. And then we ain't even got to the drug gang. Why is that? Do it sound right? It don't even sound right. If it don't sound right, goddammit, you know it ain't right. It don't even sound right. How it look? Do it look right? We have four young black boys. Didn't want to join no gang. How that sound? What is you talking about? See, the thing about it, what's supposed to be important, they supposed to be important that in this community, we don't have no gangs. So if we find out that there's some kind of stupid stuff going on, that's what's supposed to be reported. Not that these young folk, black boys, didn't want to join a street gang. What is you talking about? Ain't no such thing as no street gang. And you got a school teacher in the classroom. What is you talking about? And you got a vice principal and a principal and a counselor in every school. In every school. And you mean to tell me you got a gang problem? In every school, in elementary school, the junior high school, and in the high school. And you mean to tell me you got a gang problem? You got a street gang problem? You got a drug gang problem? Now, that don't make sense. Let me continue reading here. It says here, the tension occurred when the teens confessed to Zaza Heard, the CEO at LaGrange Housing Authority, that all four of them had been approached to join gangs and wanted to stay out of trouble. The interaction prompted her to write a moving Facebook post on which she said, "I hired them on the spot. The streets will not have our cheer." It says here that Dalek Smith is 13. Jalen Parham, he's 13. And twin brothers, Desmond and Dion Woodard, 14. Now tend to a community garden, pass out flyers, and perform other odd jobs around the Grange Housing Authority for $7.25 an hour. Said Heard told the Huffington Post that they're even building new picnic benches for the community from scratch. Says here the teens have been consistently asking Heard for jobs since May when their school year ended for summer break. Said, but Heard assumed that the boys wanted to work purely for monetary reasons. Said, I thought they just wanted to work for money, she told her folks. Heard finally gave the boys an opportunity on July 26th, telling them she had to speak to the financial department and the Grange Housing Authority about hiring them first. But if they came by her office the next day, she had talked to them about possibility. She made an appointment with them for 11 a.m. for July. The young men arrived at her office the next day at 10:15 a.m. Heard then asked the team why they wanted to work, assuming that they would say they wanted money to respond. Heard got it. Instead surprised her. That's when Desmond told me, we just don't want to be in games. Heard said the other three teams turned their heads away, but would have pressed on. He said, tell her the truth. Tell her they've approached all of us, not just me. The boys confirmed that they had been approached by gangs. And I knew then we had to put them to work fast, Heard said. The boys were hired that day, and Heard posted about the experience on Facebook. And said, so far the post has received over 600 shares, over 400 likes, and comments from people beaming with support. Okay, that's enough. Now, for all those listening, you can go to www.huffingtonpost.com. And it says, teen boys get jobs to avoid gangs in Georgia. That's in the Huffington Post. And click right over here. Let me see here. Now, you can also go to Essence Magazine, and the title of the story is Essence.com 2016. CEO hires four black teens who asked for jobs after being approached to join gangs. So you can read the same story. And the same stories in Essence Magazine. Don't sound right. Don't sound right at all. Don't sound right at all. Okay, we're gonna go over here to we're gonna go over here to the root.com, and the reason why we're gonna go to root.com before we get into some of the issues that we're gonna bring up is I'll let you speak for a second. The title, the root.com, is Reverse Racism a Thing?
Believe discrimination against nearly half of Americans believe discrimination against white people is as big a problem as discrimination against people of color. Some people call this reverse racism. But here's the thing. If racism were reversed, that would mean racism wouldn't exist in the first place. And by calling discrimination against white people reverse racism, you're also acknowledging the power dynamic, saying that white people are the primary upholders of racism, which actually is true. That can't be reversed unless hundreds of years of systemic oppression are erased. White people can experience prejudice and discrimination from people of color racial prejudice typically starts with the belief in stereotypes about groups of people. Racial discrimination is all about actions and unfair treatment based on prejudice. And racism is a form of discrimination based on skin color and ethnic origin. It's kept alive through power and institutional reinforcement. In the United States, prejudice towards people of color is still supported by our most powerful institutions, which means racism is still very much alive. And it didn't magically disappear because we have a black president. Black people, for example, experienced 250 years of slavery in the United States and 100 years of legalized discrimination with black codes and Jim Crow. In the years to follow, legal discrimination still continued in the form of housing discrimination, job discrimination, no positive representation on television, the war on drugs, mass incarceration, the school-to-prison pipeline, stop and frisk, and so much more. So when things like affirmative action, BET, and Black Lives Matter pop up, these things are there in an effort to level the playing field, not to tip the scale the other way. If white people experienced racism, they would have to undergo hundreds of years of legal oppression, just like people of color still do. White people can experience discrimination in many ways, and it's not okay. Racism just isn't one of them.
Okay, that was TheRoot.com is reverse racism a thing. So now we're gonna get into some things that we continue to be reported is about the police department here in America. The police department here in America, law enforcement. They didn't say law enforcement here in the United States of America. It's continued to be reported that the white law enforcement people throughout America are continuing to abuse the authority, continue to violate the civil and human rights of black African Americans, regardless of age or gender. And recently, there's been reported that, we see here on CNN, woman killed in standoff with Baltimore County Police was live streaming. The lady's name was, young lady's name was Corinne Gaines. And basically, African American woman who was killed after a 7-hour standoff with Baltimore County Police was trying to live stream the event. Thornton said, and said during the standoff, police requested that Facebook deactivate her account on the service and on Instagram, which Facebook owns. Baltimore County Police Chief Jim John told Fox News, the Facebook account, which allowed live streaming, was taken offline, but 2 1-minute videos were still on her Instagram account as of Tuesday afternoon. Say the video was posted just before Corinne Shadon Gaines, she was 23 years old, was killed in an exchange of gunfire, which a 5-year-old boy was wounded in the arm. In one video, a tactical officer appears in the doorway of an apartment. There is talking that is hard to discern, but there is no apparent conversation between the officer and Gaines. The video has since been taken down. Saying the other video, Gaines talks to the boy who gives Hawks an answer, which raises the possibility the boy might have been coached. Gaines and her ask the boy what the police are trying to do. He answers, they're trying to kill us. The boy is being treated for non-life-threatening injuries at the John Hawks Hospital in Baltimore, where he is in good condition, police said. It says, Fun to report a question about whether police have deactivated gang's social media account during the standoff. John said law enforcement has no power to deactivate an account. Facebook has a portal for law enforcement requests, though, and police did ask the social media giant to deactivate her account. To preserve the integrity of the negotiation, Facebook complied, he said. Gang was posting videos operating some of her followers, urged her not to follow police orders. Johnson said gangs had a shotgun, police say. Around 9:20 Monday morning, three warrant service officers went to serve a man and a woman in the Randallstown area of Baltimore County, Maryland, and said that said upon arriving, the officers heard the voices of a man, woman, and a child crying inside the apartment. It says here that the officer obtained a key to the apartment about 10 minutes. And then said the man, Kareem Courtney, 39, was wanted on an assault warrant while gang was wanted on a bench warrant for failure to appear in court to face traffic charges, police said. Gaines had a Mossberg 12-gauge shotgun, which she pointed at police, Johnson said. Records show she bought the gun last year. The officer called for a tactical team and waited. Not long into the standoff, Courtney left the apartment with a one-year-old child and was arrested. They left Gaines and the five-year-old in the home. It says that Gaines facilitated between agitated and calm during the encounter. It says she claimed that several times she pointed a shotgun at the officers. It says the woman threatened the officer. It says around 4 p.m. after hours of the standoff, the woman threatened the officers verbally and with the weapon, according to the police. Said, if you don't leave, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill you. It said one police officer fired a shot and gangs fired back with double buckshot. Officers responded with three shots and the woman was struck. Police didn't say why the first officer fired. It said the five-year-old boy was hit in the arm during the crossfire. So, this time it was an African American woman, young woman, 23 years old, and only wanted on a misdemeanor traffic violation, appearing in court. And, other person that was the man that was in the apartment, he him and 1 year old police let him walk on out the door but left. You know, she's still sitting in the apartment preparing them with a 12-gauge shotgun and a 5 year old. And she ended up getting killed. And the 5 year old, he ended up getting a gunshot wound that he being treated for. And and then, no, that's not the only incident. It was another incident been reported. A young black man in Chicago. I didn't even look it up. But what I did look up was is the number, you know, like the statistics, the numbers of African American people of all backgrounds, and people that have been killed by the police, regardless of race, age, gender, whatever religion. And I was able to find some very compelling information, and I'd like to refer everyone to go to www.theguardian.com The title of the article here, that counted, like count number C-O-U-N-T, counted police killings U.S. database. So you find the same information. What we have here, some very, very accurate information here. Okay, at the very top, that way when you look for it, you'll know what you're seeing. It's going to say the county people killed by police in the U.S. And it's going to have people killed in 2016. According to this, it said 640. And then you have race and ethnicity per million total. 0.56 Asian Pacific Islanders, 1.54 white, 1.77 Hispanic Latino, 3.991 black, and 5.49 Native American. And then it also at the top has the state. They got all 50 states, okay? Let's just say New Mexico. The total number of people that have been killed in New Mexico, 17 so far in New Mexico, out of a population of 2 million. Let's go to Alaska. The total number of people being killed in Alaska, 5. South Dakota, total number of people being killed, 5. The District of Columbia, D.C., District of Columbia. The total number of people that have been killed by police, according to this, in 2016, 3. Oklahoma, the total number of people that have been killed by the police, 17. Hawaii, the total number of people been killed, 6. Alabama, total number of people been killed, 19. Montana, total number killed, 4. Arizona, 26. Colorado, 19. Wyoming, 2. Louisiana, 15. Nevada, 8. Arkansas, 8. Mississippi, 8. Nebraska, 5. Kentucky, 11. Oregon, 10. Missouri, 15. Wisconsin, 14. California, 88. West Virginia, 4. Florida, 42. South Carolina, 10. Utah, 6. North Carolina, 20. Tennessee, 13. Texas, 54. Rhode Island, 2. Georgia, 19. Washington, 13. Idaho, 3. Virginia, 15. Kansas, 5. Maryland, 10. Indiana, 11. Vermont, 1. Minnesota, 8. Illinois, 18. Massachusetts, 9. North Dakota, 1. Ohio, 13. Michigan, 11. Delaware, 1. Iowa, 3. New York, 19. Pennsylvania, 12. Connecticut, 3. New Jersey, 7. Maine, 1. And New Hampshire, 1. That's the whole United States of America that tells you about all the police killings in each state. The total number. Total number. In regards to race or ethnicity or religion or whatever. And it says here you also have a now. In 2016, this is the month of August. So what we're gonna do, we're gonna scroll down. Let's scroll down to all the way to January. So everybody that's listening, and you look for it, you'll know what you're looking at. Let me see. Make sure I got this thing. Okay, let me see your state. Filter by state. Okay, here's state. Okay, gender. Any. Or age, any. Race, ethnicity, any. Now, who took it in, right? Or classification, any. But see, each one of these categories, see, that you can look for people that's been killed by the police. And I give you an example. When it says armed or unarmed, it can be with you can look up for people who've been killed by police with a weapon, any weapon, a firearm, a knife, other, unarmed. So you can look for armed or unarmed. Just like when it says gender, you can look up just the females, or you can look up the males, non-conforming or unknown, or just, any. Then when it says age, you can be under 18, 18 to 24, 25 to 34, 35 to 44, 45 and up. Just any age. Race, ethnicity. It can be any. It can be white, black, Hispanic, Latino, Asian, Pacific Island, Native American, other, unknown. So I left it on. Just any. Classification. Any. Gunshot. Taser. Struck by a vehicle. Death in custody. Other, unknown. So I just left it on any. So we're gonna leave it on 2016, but on here on the garden, it goes to 2015. So for everybody, this so that's how you know that that's what it is. You can go to the year 2015, and you can look up the information. Let's go over to 2015. Just right quick, see what the total number is. Okay. For the year 2015, the number of people that was killed for the year 2015 by law enforcement all around America, total number. Okay, let's say here, it says year 1,000, the total number, year of violence, race, whatever, the total number of people that were killed by police, law enforcement, in the year 2015, 1,146 or 47. Now, when it comes to race and ethnicity, per million, 1.334 Asian Pacific Island. So that's in the millions, 1.3 per million. 2.93 for the white. 3.45 Hispanic Latino, 5.49 Native American, and at the very top, 7.66 for black. So out of the whole year 2015, there were more African Americans, black, who were killed by the police than any other group. That's in the year 2015, out of 1,146 people total in the year 2015 that were killed by the police. 7.66 were black. That was it were more blacks killed, African American killed by the police than any other group. So let's go back over here to 2016. As of right now, and this is August, this is the month of August 2016 so far. The total number of people that's been killed in the year 2016 by law enforcement. is 640. Going to 641. Between 640 and 641 total in 2016. Now, let's go back over to race and ethnicity per million. Now it says 0.5656 Asian Pacific Islanders, 1.54 white, 1.77 Hispanic Latino, 3.91 black, and 5.49 Native American so far in 2016. So as of so far, Native American is at the top, 5.49, and we, you know, we still, the year not over. So let's scroll down to January. Scroll down to January. Okay, this is January 2016, and it shows people who've been killed all around the country, like some people make you in California, Louisiana, North Carolina, Montana, South Dakota, Texas. Hopefully, I tell you their name and things of nature. But in the month of January, in the month of January 2016, there were 87 people killed all around, you know, nationwide. 87 people killed for, you know, regardless of race, ethnicity, all that. A total of 87 in the month of January. And then in the month of February 2016, nationwide, the number of people that's been killed by law enforcement, 100. 100 people been killed by the police. That's in February. Okay, February, let's see, March. March 2016. 99 people been killed by law enforcement. 99. Okay, the month of April 2016. April 2016, 81 people been killed by law enforcement. 81. And in the month of May 2016. 85 people been killed by law enforcement. 85. Month of June 2016. 98 people been killed by the law enforcement. 98. Month of July 2016. 80 people been killed by law enforcement. And in the month of August 2016, so far, 10, nationwide, 10. So that's the, so like I said, for everybody that's listening, you can go to www.theguardian.com. And the title of the article is The County People Killed by Police in the U.S. And, like I say, you know, you got a person sitting up in the White House claiming that they trying to do this and they go, you know, they're not trying to do anything to stop the police with these police shootings and all this. And I mean, it's, we live in a day and time where things are being videoed, being recorded and things of this nature. And we're gonna continue to talk about today. It's been reported in the news. You've been seeing ISIS. ISIS. We go back. We had to go back to Al Qaeda. But before it was ISIS, it was this Al Qaeda stuff. And as you know, it was a war on terrorism. And Al Qaeda was pretty much defeated in the war. And many of the leaders of Al Qaeda were killed and still being killed today, because you be hearing about drone attacks. We heard about drone attacks and how many of the leaders of Al-Shabaab, they've been killed. Many of the people that was in Afghanistan, Pakistan, were killed by drone attacks. Many of them, even some that was in Iraq or may have been possibly even in Syria. But the point of this is that wherever they was trying to hide, the CIA was getting the information and was finding them, and they were being killed by drone attacks. So when it comes to Al Qaeda, pretty much Al Qaeda was defeated and they were killed. And then you had the leftovers, which you had today, ISIS. And that includes Jihad Joe. You know, people coming from the United States of America trying to leave the United States of America to go join ISIS. And, the individuals here, you know, like we talk about the street gang, the drug gang in Chicago, Illinois, and the street gang and the drug gang in Los Angeles, California. See, when it comes to Jihad Joe, see, that's who it was that came over. It was some individuals living here in America. And they were affiliated with these street gangs and drug gangs. Then they went over to the Middle East. And called themselves going to join in with ISIS. The people in the Middle East, they've been coming over to America for many years, so it's not like they're unfamiliar with the street gang culture and the drug gang culture in America. They've been coming over here, and they've been interrelating or interacting with the people here in this country. And so what you had, so now you have, now that Al Qaeda was defeated, the leftovers started ISIS. And being encouraged by Jihad Joe. Because Jihad Joe, like I said, some people live right here in America. And that street gang, that drug gang in Chicago, Illinois. And that street gang, that drug gang in Los Angeles, California, see. They got involved with the ISIS, and that's what you have. You seeing being done today, but still, you know, the U.S. government and many other governments are trying to fight against ISIS, and they pretty much have pushed them back. You know, at the beginning, when they started up, they kind of, it was like they got a head start. It was like there was a lot of enthusiasm for ISIS. But you see in today, there's been a lot of airstrikes against ISIS. But on the ground, there were many people who was given weapons to fight against ISIS. They had pretty much, push ISIS back. They were able to resist ISIS. And ISIS has been pushed back. But the situation is that they looking around trying to find somewhere to go. trying to find some place where they can get some influence, you know, where they can set up a base. Because they can't go to Afghanistan because the U.S. government got forces over there fighting against the Taliban, so they can't go there. They can't go to Pakistan. They can't stay in Iraq. Syria, you know, it's civil war in Syria, so it's not safe for them to be there. They try to sit over in Iraq right now. And, but then what they having to do now, what they doing now is trying to spread to the continent of Africa. Now, as you know, Libya, after Muammar Gaddafi was killed by some rebels, Muammar Gaddafi was killed by the rebels. Libya has been kind of unstable. So now ISIS is looking for somewhere to set up shop. Since Egypt wasn't a place where they can go. Tunisia wasn't a place they can go. Algeria, they couldn't go to Algeria, they couldn't go to Morocco. So they had to find some kind of government, some place where they can go, where there was not a stable government. So now they trying to set up in Libya. So now the U.S. government is trying to carry out airstrikes in Libya. And then, you know, also ISIS has been trying to support Al-Shabaab in Somalia. You've been hearing about the bombs blowing up in Somalia, things of nature, and the terrorist attacks. And like in Kenya, you see ISIS been claiming responsibility. Then you got Boko Haram. Boko Haram trying to appoint a new leader over Boko Haram because the other person apparently is I guess ineffective. So you have ISIS trying to have influence in the Nigeria, Cameroon area, because now they trying to appoint some person to be over Boko Haram. See? And then you have another situation that could be a problem. ISIS is trying to find somebody that'll, you know, be their friend. So you have a problem that you have in South Sudan. You have a civil war in South Sudan. And you have ISIS trying to set up shop in Libya. They're appointing somebody over. They've been appointed a new leader over Boko Haram. This is what ISIS did. And then you have a civil war in South Sudan, but the people that live, the North Sudanese, have been bombing South Sudan. That's what the North Sudanese have been doing. They've been bombing North South Sudan. So you never assume that ISIS don't have some influence in North Sudan. And you don't never assume that there are not people living in South Sudan with that Muslim, Islam stuff who are not listening to ISIS. You don't never assume that. You don't never assume that there's not a person walking around that's not influenced, because ISIS has been having influence with all kind of people all around where you see bombs or you got white people in Europe. See, we had to break it down to the common, you know, common with everybody. You see, ISIS started to have influence with all kind of people all around the planet. See? You're hearing all these terrorist attacks, and now you have, in Europe. It's not just in the Middle East. The people that was in the Middle East are migrating, leaving the Middle East, and they end up in Europe. And then you have all these terrorist attacks in Europe. So when you have a government, when you have a South Sudan, the Nile of Sahara, there's a lot of people that are Nile of Sahara that profess Islam, profess to be a Muslim. So you don't never say that ISIS don't have some influence in South Sudan. That's what you do say. Because there's a civil war going on and you don't know who all these people are. Then you have people that are in the refugee camps. So what's going to have to be done is what I've been saying all the time. We're going to attack ISIS. We're going to go over there. Not going to sit around and sit idly by and then give you the impression that we're just going to sit around and build up a whole bunch of forces and just going to put up a defense on the African. Hell no. Hell no. I'm coming over to Iraq. I'm coming over to Syria. We're going to leave the continent of Africa and we're going to come to the Middle East. And we're going to attack ISIS and anybody else. Hell no. We ain't finna build no damn defense and on continent Africa. We're coming to the Middle East. And we're going to attack your ass. You're not getting away with nothing. Ain't no. You talking about some jihad joke? No. You not getting away with a damn thing. I'm coming to the Middle East. You bank on that. That's a guarantee. And no, ain't no such thing. No, ain't no building no goddamn defense force. And then we're gonna just sit in the corner. Oh hell no. No. That's out the question. No. No. We coming to the Middle East. And anywhere else, we gotta come. To kill ISIS or anybody else who threaten the security, the safety and security. A self-Africa, no, hell no. You ain't getting away with nothing. No. And, other things that's been, been brought up, that's came up, that's been reported. You know, this person that sits up in the White House, calls himself the president, calls himself an African American, and him and his wife assumed that they was just so smart, and so they had to come up with this young African Leadership Initiative. Now, this is last year in office. And when you think you're so smart, you're so slick, you're trying to be so slick with other people that it's just like the street gang and the drug gang. You know, you live here in the United States of America, and and you think you're making a fool out of people that live in sub-Saharan Africa, and that's Congo, and then you think you're making a fool out of other people. You think you're so small, so slick. You're so conniving. But you're not getting over on anybody. But that's what him and his wife sits up in the White House trying to do. They're trying to make you look like you're a fool, like you're stupid. This is like people that live here in the United States that come from sub-Saharan Africa. Just like might be a professor and might be working at the school. You understand? Then you come over here to America and you're working at the university. And then you see all the students coming to the school. And they come from all parts, they come from all places, all over America. All over America. And then when you see them walking around, they come up to the school. And now we got online today. Now you got online. But when you're going to be on campus and you have people that work here and live here and they work, live here in America. They come from sub-Saharan Africa, not Chicago. Some might be not sub-Saharan. Then you got all these Afro-Asiatic people that live here in America. And then you got people walking around talking about they in a damn street gang. You think you're so smart. You're so slick. You're getting over on somebody. See, that's the way they act. They getting over. You're making a fool out of others because you're so slick and you're so smart. It's your conniving ass. And that's what that yelling stuff is. That young African leadership. All it is not. See, the people got colleges and universities in sub-Saharan Africa. These people are already educated. Already been to college and already got a degree. And then you got somebody sitting up in the White House trying to self-promote themselves by using other people who already got education, who already been educated at colleges and universities in sub-Saharan Africa. All those professors in sub-Saharan Africa who taught these people. Then you see this individual sitting up in the White House. See, the whole point, it's not about trying to help anybody in sub-Saharan Africa. The young African leadership in this is about trying to promote Barack Obama, him and his wife. That's what it's about. See, in and everything that he do is about promoting him. Even the upcoming presidential election, it's about who he endorsed. So he goes up there and gives a speech. To endorse Hillary Clinton. See, it wasn't about Hillary Clinton, it was about him. And that's the same thing with these yachts. See, it's not about these women and men. Who've already gone to school, who've already been educated in sub-Saharan Africa, many of them already been to college, already graduated college. In sub-Saharan Africa. See, this is how the street gang that him and his wife thought they were smart to try to spread the street gang in sub-Saharan Africa through the young African leadership initiative. See? And see, what they're trying to do, they're trying to use you. See, this is what you have to understand. See, you don't never ever see them as what, except for what they are. A bunch of no good for nothing, lying street gang members. And that he'll try to use the Yali, him and some of them other ones up sitting up there in Chicago, like the Nation of Islam and the Hebrew Israelites. See, they sit up there in Chicago, and then they use the people in Los Angeles, then they spread this mess all around the country. And see, this is another way where they're trying to do the same thing in sub-Saharan Africa. See, they're trying to use you. See, just like Michelle Obama, see, she's from Chicago. See, she'll try to use anybody. She'll try to use anybody. So somebody over here in America, some little boy, some little girl, will sit around and listen to them. And then they'll be a part of the gang. But you know the reason why? It'll be because Michelle Obama are trying to claim that somebody in sub-Saharan Africa. See, it's getting to the point where you can't say you're from Chicago no more. See, that's how they used to do it. That's what they've been doing. People go try to live in Chicago, try to move to Chicago. And then they go around trying to they lead us in Chicago. See, this is what's happening now, is that you have people from sub-Saharan Africa. And you got all these people that are Afro-Asiatic from North Africa coming to America, including the Nile of Saharan. But see, this Islam and this religion stuff, Christianity, see, this is another way that the gang gets sprayed. And this is the same thing that Yali. See, this is what him and his wife and some of the others up there in Chicago thought. That this is another way for them to try to spread the gang. Now they're trying to use you to spread the street gang and the drug gang. That's what they know. See, this is what the truth is about the Yali. See, it's not about trying to make Africa better or anything. It's about them trying to spread the gang. They're trying to use you. You see how some of these celebrities be trying to come over to sub-Saharan Africa. See, this is how they're trying to use you. They're trying to use you. That's what they're doing. They're trying to use you. See, there's no such thing as a street gang. No such thing as a drug gang. That's what they're yelling stuff. They're trying to use. They're trying to use the people in sub-Saharan Africa. They're trying to use to spread the street gang and the drug gang. That's what they know. And there had to be people to stop them and not let them get away. Because first of all, you got all these colleges and universities. There's no such thing as a street gang. No such thing as no drug gang. They're like a sorority fraternity, made up. So that's what we have to do when it comes to the that young African leadership in this, we have to inform the people that's in sub-Saharan Africa and all the other people that's on the continent of Africa. that the street gang and the drug gang in Chicago, Illinois, the street gang and the drug gang in Los Angeles, California, is trying to get influence on the continent of Africa. And it must be stopped. They have to be stopped. And we know, in the news today, the Olympics have started, the 2016 Olympics in Rio, Brazil started. So we know that there are a lot of people all around the world watching the Olympics and cheering for all the athletes and things and that, supporting all the athletes. So, while the Olympics is going on, just enjoy the Olympics. We're gonna get tired of reading now. Be reading from the book titled West African Traditional Religion, written by Dr. Joseph Onosede Ebulelo and Dr. P. Adelumo Do Pemu. We're going to be reading from the introduction. We're going to be continuing reading from the introduction. Mama is a Melanesian word which has been used by anthropologists to mean an impersonal power pervading the universe, but regarded with great dread and awe. S.S. Farrell pointed out that the term is used to denote a mysterious power or influence, which is supernatural and beyond the power of the senses to detect or of the mind to explain. Anything that eludes human imagination, any power or skill possessed by a man, but which is beyond the average. Any unusual success in war, hunting, and farming may be attributed. To mana. The word mana is used by both Lucas and Pharaoh to refer to Yaruba, Ogun, magic, or medicine. Some writers have even regarded mana as the impersonal force that controls the world of the West African peoples. In any of its various forms, the term mana should not be used to refer to anything in West Africa. West African peoples possess primary and intelligible terms for their concepts and ideas. We should use their own terms when we find it difficult to find a suitable and comprehensive English equivalent to describe their concepts. ancestral worship. Some Western investigators have described the religion of the West African peoples as ancestral worship. They think that all that the people regarded as spiritual beings are no more than deified ancestors. The question of ancestor worship will be dealt with fully elsewhere, but suffice it to say here that belief in the ancestor is an element in the religion of West African peoples everywhere. We find ancestral cults. These ancestors are venerated and they receive regular offerings from their offspring. However, ancestor worship cannot be the name for the religion. It is just an element out of other elements, and it is not more important than other elements. To deserve the exclusive right of being the name for the religion, there is more in the religion than the veneration of ancestors, as we shall use, as we shall see later. We're going to stop right there. I'm going to read from the introduction from the book titled West African Traditional Religion, written by Dr. Joseph Omaseda Avalelu and Dr. P. Adelumo Dopemu. We're going to continue our reading from the book titled African Traditional Religion, a definition written by Dr. E. Baloja Adowu. Read from chapter 4, The Nature of African Traditional Religion. What term to use? This is the real question. Anyone who has really studied the situation carefully must sympathize with those who have found it rather difficult to find a name that is precisely descriptive of the real nature of the religion and understand why they either take refuge in definitive terms which are unsuitable or glibly tack on it to names, the only excuse for which is that they have the support of some pet theory or long usage. P.A. Tabor is faced with this problem with reference to the religion of Southern Nigeria, but wisely, he does not force a solution. Rather, he leaves it as starting the fact as he sees it and no more. On the whole, the religion strongly resembles that of the ancient Egyptians, who combined a belief in the existence of an omnipotent an omniscient supreme God with that in multitudes of subordinate deities. E. Jeffrey Parenda also recognized the problem in his study of religion in Abadan, and is wise enough to leave it at, it would be useful to devise a term which would denote religions that have a supreme God and also worship other gods. S.F. Nadal had been far-reaching and discerning in his approach to the problem, writing with particular reference to the new. He says, here we might note that the new have no special collective name for their religion. They have names only for a particular conception, single practices, local ceremonies. As for the total creed, the new can describe it only circuitously and enumeratively as being concerned with the god Soko and not with deity's name differently, with such and such rituals or medicines and not with others, with spirits, but no anthropomorphous ones, and so forth. Nadal emphasized the fact that the new refer everything to God as the one ultimate. I do not know of any place in Africa where the ultimacy is not accorded to God. That is why, because this is very true of the Yoruba. I conclude that the religion can only be adequately described as monotheistic. I modify this monotheism by the adjective diffused, because here we have a monotheism in which there exist other powers which derive from deity. Such being an authority that they can be treated for practical purpose, almost as ends in themselves. The descriptive phrase implicit monotheism will serve as well as diffused monotheism. We may compare the system among the Yoruba, where we have divinities who appear to be completely autonomous, each with his or her own priesthood and set of rituals. A priest would bear, for example, the title of Osogun, the priest of Ogun, or Olobatala, the priest of Obatala. But the unity of the whole is manifested phenomenologically in that the head of the whole community is the pontifex maximus of all the cults together. Hence the saying, every festival is the king's festival, and of course none of the cults have any meaning apart from Oludumare, the supreme god. We must heed the observation that all down the ages, peoples have worshipped without being preoccupied with finding names for their religion. It is the outsider, the observer, the investigator, the curious, the detractor, or the busybody who first applied labels. The exception is Islam, which came into being with its name. We have undertaken the exercise of supplying an essential name to African traditional religion purely because of the need of a handle for the purpose of study. And this is not an easy task, as the local names for deity differ from place to place, and there is no single common name for deity known to and accepted by all Africans. Thus, for a precise definitive name apart from diffused monotheism, we should have to employ the local name used for God in each area. The defect in this is that we shall be landed with names rather than a name. Thus, we shall have a bewildering number of unwarranted unwarrantedism, Oludumareism for the Yoruba, Chukwuism for the Igbo Nigerian, Onyamism for the Akan, Ngowism for the Mende of Sierra Leone, or Imanism for the Urundu. As the case may be, if we are anglicizing the term, if we are using the vernacular, we should have to find in each case the composite word which means the word of deity. Using the local name for deity, for example, the case of the Yoruba, as one of the reviewers of Oludamare suggested, this would be its Oludamare. I seen Oludamare, the service or worship of Oludamare. Thus, the German word got his dense, which means literally service or worship of God, and by connotation embraces the inward and outward aspects of religion. Would be appropriate as a general name for the religion as it points to its very essence. We'll start right there. And we've been reading from chapter 4, The Nature of African Traditional Religion. And we've been reading from the book titled African Traditional Religion, A Definition by Dr. E. Baloja Idabu. We're going to continue our reading from the book titled African Religions and Philosophy, written by Dr. John S. M. Beebe. Be reading from the chapter number 16, Mystical Power, Magic, Witchcraft, and Sorcery. Now, in the other book written by Dr. Joseph Omosede Ebelelu and Dr. P. Adelumo Dopengu, there was a chapter titled Mystical Powers, Magic, Witchcraft, and Sorcery that was just been read. So I don't want anybody to think that I'm reading the same book again, because I'm not. One book had information, and then now there's another different book by a different writer. But it's pretty much talking about the same topic, subject. Said, on the subject of magic and witchcraft in Africa, there is a great deal of literature, and yet one is struck and disappointed by the large amounts, by the large amount of ignorance, prejudice, falsification, which keeps coming out in modern books, newspapers, and conversation on this subject. Discussion is centered on two camps at opposite ends. The larger camp has those who expose their own ignorance, false ideas, exaggerated prejudices, and a derogatory attitude which belittles and despises the whole concept of mystical power. The other is represented by a few scholars who seriously consider African views, fears, uses, and manipulation of this power. Most of the distorted ideas have come through European and American popular writers, missionaries, and colonial administrators. Every African who has grown up in the traditional environment will, no doubt, know something about this mystical power, which differs. No, excuse me, which often is experienced or manifests itself in form of magic, divination, witchcraft, and mysterious phenomena. They seem to deify even immediate scientific explanation. I shall illustrate this with a few stories, and then make some general observation. I'm gonna stop right there, because we're gonna come back. We've been reading from chapter 16, Mystical Power, Magic, Witchcraft, and Sorcery. We've been reading from the book titled African Religions and Philosophy, written by Dr. John S. M. Beattie. And we're going to continue our reading from the book titled Concepts of God in Africa, written by Dr. John S. M. Beebe. Let me read from part 4, God and Man, number 14, the creation and original state of man. The creation of man is a process or evolution. We have one concept from among the fun in which the creation of man is presented as a process or an evolution. On the first day, God set the world in order and then formed man out of clay and water. The third day, God gave man sight, speech, and knowledge for the eternal world. On the fourth day, man was given technical skills, which evidently equipped him to live on this earth. The original state and nature of the first man. According to the many myths, the state of the original man was one of happiness, childlike ignorance, immortality, or the ability to rise again after dying. God provided man with the necessities of life, and man lived more or less in a paradise. The Alleluia narrate that the first couple lived in a house which was suspended in the air by poles. From there, they descended by ladder to the ground, and every time they went back to their house and pulled up the ladder. For many years, the man and his wife did not know how to have sexual intercourse, but finally, they discovered how to do it, and the wife became pregnant. The first child was a son named Lalembo, and the second a daughter called Nacio. The two children grew up and married each other, from whom were born sons. The first couple also begat two more daughters, and these married their nephews. Through this intermarriage, mankind increased upon the earth. God originally endowed men with the gift of immortality. In the Bagusu version of this myth, it is told that in their ignorance, the first man and wife attempted sexual intercourse in the armpit, but discovered the right organs which the wife climbed, the granary to get millet, and her husband watched her from beneath. At first she refused to sleep with him, and when she finally agreed, it was painful, but a month later she conceived. In that way, men began to increase upon the earth. According to the Ashanti, the first man enjoyed a privileged position in creation. God made things for man's use and protection. He ordered animals to eat the plants, and he ordered man to do the same and to drink from the waters. He also ordered man to use the animals as meat. Lastly, he created the gods to protect men. The Bakango summarized the original state of man in their common saying that man is God's man. does man especially connect him with God as his property, linking him with God in a way that other creatures are not so intimately linked. In one of the Bambudan myths, it is told that the first people lived happily, lacking nothing, as God provided them with food, shelter, and immortality. When they grew old, God rejuvenated them, and they became young once more. The Tiswane say that the primeval state was one of happiness, peace, and blissness. The men neither ate nor drank nor died. The Miru also believe that the primeval men did not eat, did not need to eat or drink. The Fajulu picture two worlds that existed long ago, linked by rope. Made of cowhide. The inhabitants of both worlds held dance parties and festivities, inviting one another by the sound of the drum. It was a very happy state of affairs, which ended only when the hyena cut the rope in two. The Lubari and other peoples in the upper White Nile Valley tell similar myths in which men and God were originally in direct contact. According to the Zulu, the first man came into being already perfected as adults. The husband and wife found themselves crouching in a bed of reeds, but did not see the one who had created them. But the story goes on to say that God gave them the following order: let man circumcise, that they may not be boys. And get ready to end right there. We'll stop right there. And we've been reading from part 4, God and Man, the creation and original state of man. And we've been reading from the book titled Concepts of God in Africa, written by Dr. John S. M. Beattie. End today's video. We're gonna make reference to what we've been studying, our languages, our Niger Congo languages specific. We know that some Niger Congo languages can be found on ilanguage.org. or learn101.org, or you can find some YouTube videos, and you can find some Niger Congo languages on YouTube, and you can go online and do some kind of searches, and you can come up with some kind of way of practicing and learning the Niger Congo languages. And like we was talking about last week, the Peace Corps going all around the world for the United States government. And when you go to these different countries, you have to understand, you have to be able to relate to people, because you have and various cultures and customs around the world. So we're gonna refer to a Peace Corps before we end today's video. Okay. Like I said, Peace Corps going all around the world. And you go to all these different countries, you got to be able to interact, you got to be able to relate with the people. So you got to be able to understand the culture and the customs. And that includes understand the language. They got language training, cross-cultural training, health training, additional training to like Peace Corps in Malawi. No, that's what I'm looking at right now. I'm looking at Peace Corps Malawi. Now this is the Peace Corps right here. Learn Chichewa book, lesson 1-10, Peace Corps language Chichewa. One through ten, the Peace Corps language handbook series. See, that's the like I said, you. The Peace Corps go all around the world. That was just one. See, this is one of them. The Peace Corps got the Chichewa. That's one of the languages in Malawi. And the Peace Corps go to Malawi, so he had to learn the language. We're gonna come back on my next video. You know, we're gonna continue with our learning, our language. But we're gonna get ready to end today's video. Again, my name is Eric D. Johnson, also known as Rasha. I live right here in the city of Memphis, in the state of Tennessee, in the county seat. Thank all my fans, my support for your continued encouragement, support for continuing to work on my entertainment and my music interests. And until my next video, take care of yourself. Wish each and every one of you the very best.
Can't wait for the weekend.